know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercy for me every day. Your love never fails. Singer, you stay. Joy comes in the morning.
Hey there, is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible because it's the divinely inspired word of God and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
Can everyone say praise the Lord? God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. Welcome to the Irwin Church of God this morning. I said it many times before, I'll say it again. There's no other place better to be on this side of heaven than right here in God's house with the saints of God and God's people. This is the closest we are going to get to heaven is right here in the house of the Lord. Give Him praise this morning. I got a couple of announcements I want to announce this morning really quick before we get started. The virtual women's conference will be on March 25th at 7 p.m. Eddie James will be here on March the 31st at 6:30 p.m. We have our Easter jam at the meal on April the 3rd at 11 a.m. And let's pray for Pastor Cowan this morning. He's not here with us. He's not feeling too well. Let's keep him in your prayers. Let's just keep those that are sick this morning in your prayers. Good to see Sister Joan back with us again this morning. Let's keep her in your prayers. And many others that are not with us for whatever reason, those that are sick, there's still a lot of sickness going around. And those that are not able to be with us for whatever reason, but most importantly for the lost this morning. Every single one of us has lost friends and family, people that don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the greatest prayer request and the greatest prayer need, the most urgent prayer need that we have in the day and the hour that we're living in and the time and today is for lost souls. Let's pray for our International Youth Director, David Blair. He is in the hospital. I don't know the extent of that, but let's keep him in your prayers. And many other needs that we have in this church house this morning, let's just approach the throne of grace and mercy with open hearts. Psalms 100 says, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before His presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that has made us, and we have not made ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving and to His courts with praise. Be thankful to Him and bless His holy name, for the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endures for all generations." Stand to your feet this morning. With open hearts and minds, lift your hands to the heavens this morning. Come into His presence with thanksgiving and with praise, and lift your need before the throne of grace and mercy this morning. Father God, in the mighty name and upon the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, holy is your name, and glory be to your name. We exalt you, Lord Jesus. We exalt you, Father. We thank you, God, for another day. This is the day that you have made. Let us rejoice in your presence this morning. Let thy will be done. Let thy kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven. Touch us this morning, God. Meet every need in this church house, for the needs are many. Heal the sick this morning, God. Heal the brokenhearted this morning, oh Lord. Save the lost, God. Bring repentance, God, and conviction, Lord, upon our community and upon our nation this morning. Sanctify the believers in your house this morning. Draw us close unto you. Consecrate us unto your presence, oh Lord. and pour out your Holy Ghost fire and baptize us and fill us, God, with your Holy Ghost anointing this morning. Oh, Lord Jesus, we praise you. Nourish us, oh, Lord, our God. Nourish our vessels with your word of truth and your spirit this morning, oh, God. We love you, Lord. Feed us this day our daily bread, oh, Jesus. Forgive us our sin and wash us clean, oh God, with the power of your spirit and your word of truth as we come before your presence. Oh God, condition our hearts and our minds to receive your glory this morning. We praise you, for yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise you. We praise you.
Name than the name. Touching his body this morning, and I'm gonna come down. If anybody else needs a touch in your body this morning, you're welcome to come down and let us lay hands on you this morning, because there's nothing impossible for our God. Nothing impossible at all. I'm about sick of this COVID, I'm gonna tell you that. I'm ready for God to take this mess out of here. And I'm ready for the fear that it has brought to get out of here in the name of Jesus. We got to plead the blood of Jesus against this thing. Don't let it control us. Because that's what he wants to do. That's exactly what the devil wants to do, is control us. And we have to stand firm on God's word. We can't just believe half of God's word. We have to believe the whole Bible from the front to the beginning. It has attacked so many people. And I come against it in the name of Jesus. not just COVID. There's cancer out there that's tagging people. There's so many sicknesses that the devil tries to bring upon people's lives. But our God is greater, and we have to stand firm upon His word and trust in Him that He's going to see us through. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Hold it here. Shut the door. Shut the door. Shut the door. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Come on, help me say.
y'all help me sing this today.
So when I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground, it makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory.
Does God make anybody want to shout this morning? Come on. Did anybody come to praise the Lord this morning? Through my situation, through my heartache, through my hurt feelings, I know I come to shout because of Jesus. My flesh may be down, but my spirit is weak and strong in Jesus. Pastor's flesh may be weak this morning, but I believe his spirit is strong. Is anybody's spirit strong this morning in the Lord? Amen. Anybody come to give a shout of praise? Woo. God is good. Somebody look to your left and your right and say, God is good. Amen. I'm going to let you sit down for just a moment. If you'll have a seat for just a moment. We talk about, I exalt thee, Lord, and how good God is. And I believe at this time we've got a special time before us to give God the exalt thee. One of the greatest ways to do that, I believe, is doing a baby dedication. Dedicating a child to the kingdom. Amen. I don't believe you can do much more for your child than dedicating them to God. Can I get an amen? Does anybody believe in dedicating their children to the Lord? The one that gave them to you to start with? At this time, I've been blessed to be asked to do a baby dedication. My praise team, if you would just step to the side over here for me for a moment. I switched up the schedule and they were a little confused this morning. I apologize for that. But God is able, amen. We'll have the Pleasant family, if you'll stand. And those that would like, you can come on upstage and be with me. And my wonderful wife, if she'll join me. Amen. Where there's a will, there is a way. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on their children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Then the little children were brought to Jesus for him to be place his hands on them and pray for them. But the disciples rebuked those who brought them. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." When he had placed his hands on them, he went on from there. Children are a gift from God. Psalms 127 and 3 says, proclaims that sons are a heritage from the Lord, children a reward from him. As believers are called to recognize that children belong first and foremost to God, God in his goodness gives children as gifts to parents. They not only have the awesome responsibility for caring for this gift, but also the wonderful privilege of the joy in the gift. Because children belong to God and are given by grace as gifts to parents, it is only proper and appropriate that children be dedicated back to the Lord. We are told in 1 Samuel 1 that Hannah presented her son Samuel to the Lord. In Luke 2 and 22, we read that Mary and Joseph brought their baby Jesus to the temple in Jerusalem in order to present him before the Lord. And in that same way, we have Dylan and Courtney today bring their son, Jensen, presenting first themselves and then their son before the Lord our God. Dylan and Courtney, by coming before God and his people, do you hereby declare your desire to dedicate yourselves and your son, your son Jensen, to the Lord? If so, please respond by saying, "We do." Promise number one, do you hear this day recognize your child as a gift from God and give heartfelt thanks for God's blessings? Answer, we do. Do you hear this day dedicate your child to the Lord who gave them to you? Do you hear this day pledge as a parent that you will bring your child up in the nature of the Lord? Now, to everyone, hear this day pledge, do you all can direct Jensen toward a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? If so, say, we do. Having heard these vows and sacred assurances as a minister of Christ, I joyfully and with earnest prayer commend your child, Jensen, to the gracious keeping of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Your child may not remember this day. Therefore, tell him early of the commitment and prayers made this day in his behalf. I, at this time, want to anoint Jensen Gary Pleasant to be in our Father's care, protection, and that his angels will always be around Jensen throughout his life. Let us pray. Our Father, let your blessings be upon Jensen and guide these parents. We pray by your light and your truth that in humbleness and sincerity that they shall walk before you. In the righteousness with a sense of divine guidance, all that the days grant, we beseech you the holy desires of their hearts concerning this child. Now thank you for your dear son that you gave to us to be our Savior. In Jesus Christ's name. This time, Courtney, you have blessed and wonderful children, and I want to thank you from the Irwin Church of God for dedicating your children to the Lord. One of the greatest things you can ever give your children. At this time, Miss Candace, I present you. Dylan, you're not left alone, man. I know you had a part in this, and sometimes us fathers feel like everybody looks to the mother. But as I know that our sons and our daughters, they look up to us. And so I will ask you to please keep Jensen in light and guide him and direct his path. And Jensen, this is your first Bible from the Irwin Church of God. We love you and we thank you and continue to follow the path of God. The Pleasant family. Amen. Amen. The praise team will make their ways behind me. You know, Pastor or Sister Cowan called me about 10 minutes to 8 this morning and said Pastor has some bad headaches and it won't go away and he wasn't feeling well. And needed me to speak this moment or this morning. And at that time, I was at the media booth and I was planning on trying to run media stuff. And because Miss Courtney has been so blessing to our church and running our media for a few years now, I didn't want today to have to be her running anything. So I made sure Mr. Billy has blessed us this morning and Mr. Shane upstairs running our media. And thankful for them today. But as they sung this morning and said, I exalt thee, I thought of what God had given me for the message today. And it's about when Paul spoke to Timothy about, son, you got to stir it up. And he spoke to him about fire, about continuing the fire. And see, what I would believe, what Paul was trying to tell Timothy in this passage of Scripture, when he said, you got to fan the flame. You got to fan the flame. He wasn't saying, Timothy, you don't have the power of the Holy Spirit. He wasn't saying, you don't have the gift of God. You don't have the Spirit inside of you. But he said, you've got to fan the flame. And see, I believe right now we live in a day and time that if there's any time, any moment that somebody around you needs to see you fanning the flame of God that's in your life. It's right now. It's in a difficult time. It's in a time when nobody knows where to turn to and nobody to look to. But they can look at you and say, man, they're still happy. No matter what's going on around them, they're still in joy. They still got a smile on their face. Even though destruction and life seems to be tearing up around them, they're still happy. How is it? Because somebody been stirring. And so I'm wondering this morning, it was amazing and glad to see people to come up to the front. Because when Paul spoke to Timothy, he reminded Timothy that he got his gift of the Holy Spirit through the laying on the hands of God. When the elders laid their hands on him, he received the Holy Spirit. You see, we got two. There's many right now, and I understand that people want to be cautious of a virus going around. And I asked some ministers the other day. People were shocked that within our church that we don't require masks and those things. And I responded back. I said, it's okay if you believe masks help and encourage people. That's fine. But don't condemn me for not. Because I can't encourage something that I don't believe in. And when I read the Bible, it says lay hands on those that are sick. I can't do that if I can't get within 6 feet. Somebody's saying, but God still got a power. No, God wrote his word before anything else happened. God wrote his word before coronavirus came around. He didn't change it because it came around. See, there's got to become a time where we grasp our opinion around the Bible scriptures and stop trying to grasp scripture around my opinion. But see, God said his word is perfect. It's not void. So if I want to heal somebody, if I want to lay hands on somebody with the healing power, I've got to entrust in the Bible that my God will take care of thee. My God has power through the laying on hands. He didn't tell me to stop. People got quiet on me. And so when they were singing, I exalt thee, and the last song you sung, I was over there praying. And I said, Lord, you've got to give a song before I speak. And you started singing, when I think about the Lord. If somebody this morning could start thinking about the Lord and what he's done for me, and stop thinking about what's around you, about what may or may not come. Because one thing's for sure, I know my God is coming. And when he starts to split the eastern skies, I want him to know that I'm thinking about his goodness. And I'm thinking about what God's doing for me. I'm not focused on anything else. But I'm focused on what God's done for me. I'm focused on what he's about to do for me. See, God said, I've built you a mansion. Are you thinking on that this morning? God said, I saved your soul. I gave you a spirit. So stop focusing on your flesh. Because your flesh ain't going to enter in to my kingdom. Ooh. Y'all sing that for me. Come on, stand up all over the house if you believe this morning that when I think about the Lord and what he's done for me, somebody needs to turn around,
stir it up. Come on, praise team. Sing it for me. If I could sing, I would.
When I think about the Lord, how he saved
yes,
me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how you healed me to the uttermost. When I think about you, Lord,
somebody needs to shout this morning. Just because I thought about the goodness of Jesus.
How you place my feet on solid ground. You know it makes me want to shout. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory.
Somebody look to your neighbor and say, God gave you a chance to shout. Woo. Woo. Amen. Amen. If you can't shout thinking about Jesus and what he's already done for you, then you better start stirring. If you can make it be seated. If you don't want to, that's fine too.
read out of 1 Corinthians 3, 11 through 15. And it says, "For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest. For the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire." Somebody say fire. "And the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved. But only as through fire the Lord rained brimstone and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah from the Lord out of the heavens." In Hebrews 12 and 29 it says, "For our God is a consuming fire." Psalms 39 and 3 says, "My heart was hot within me. While I was musing, the fire burned. Then I spoke with my tongue." Psalms 97 and 3, "A fire goes before me and burns up his enemies around me." Psalms 106 and 18 says, "A fire was kindled in their company. The flame burned up in the wicked." Romans 12 and 20 says, "Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him a drink, for in so doing, you will heap coals of fire on his head." Some people thought they were just being nice to people that didn't like them for no reason, that God just wanted you to suffer for their disliking you. But right here it says, if I be nice to him and follow God's will, he will heap coals a fire on his head. Anybody else know that fire burns? 2 Thessalonians 1 and 8 says, "And flaming fire taking vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ." Hebrews 1 and 7. "And of the angels," he says, "who makes his angels spirits, and he ministers a flame of fire." Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we come to you today, Lord God, and asking that you stir us up this morning. Lord God, that we're able to stir up the fire within us through our obedience to your word, through our shout of praise, Lord God. We ask that you touch your people, that you will make us hearers and doers of your word, Lord God, that you will bring your spirit upon us this morning, that your spirit will consume us, Father God, and be all upon the house, Lord God, and that we will fall out and speak with other tongues in your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, of course, in a wider sense, fire does all sorts of things. Fire crackles, it gives light, it warms the room. Fire produces smoke as it rages, consumes, or devours and destroys. Fire may spread, die down, or go out. But in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, it says, "For this reason I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on my hands. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and of love and self-control." You know, since we have this gift of God in us, why do we need to fan into flame? Yes, our regenerated spirit was united by the divine fire of the Spirit. But after we're saved, our zeal for the Lord may eventually fade. We're not as hot and burning as we once were when we first received the Lord. The toughest thing for Christians, when they first come to know Jesus, when they first come to know God, it's like an amazing thing happens. They become to know a new creator. They become so on fire wanting to tell everyone, "You've got to come with me to the church." They become so on fire with God. And then time passes and people wonder, what happened? Why did it fade? What happened? You see, when you first get saved, God lights the fire. But it's through your obedience of the word that fans the flame. See, if you notice, if you've ever been camping, I know Generation Now, many may have not been camping, and let us just clicking on their cell phone and throwing up a campfire. They even have on your phone, you can pull up an app that's got a candle or fire background. But if you've ever been camping and you go out in the woods and start this fire, you can't just start it without just a match. The light, the fire has to have something to catch fire to. And so you first start out with some sticks to start a small fire. See, you don't start out with huge logs. You don't start out with big, heavy wood. You start out with small sticks to get those lit and burning. And as they burn and get hotter and hotter, then you're able to lay more on it. Our problem is today, most of us want to stay at the little stick stage in God's walk. But then we want the blessings of those that have been in the fire, that have been in the flames. And we want God just to pour out his spirit upon us to give us what he's got. But the thing about that is when God blesses you more, he puts more on you. And so that heavy wood gets put on. And many of us can't handle it yet. Our fire hasn't been burnt long enough. And it starts to dwindle out, dwindle down. We don't stay in the word. We don't pray. And we wonder, wow, where's our fire? And just like that campfire, if you go to sleep that night and nobody's out there mending the fire, when you wake up in the morning, you've got nothing but smoke. You've got a residual from the fire with no heat. I wonder how many people are trying to stay living off their residual smoke, trying to show people around them, I see, I've got smoke, I've got evidence. All you got evidence is that you had a fire. But where is the fire? And see, then many people are going back to God and are saying, save me again, God. Light me on fire again. I believe God is trying to tell somebody, like Paul told Timothy, you still have embers underneath the fire pits. They're still there. You ain't got to take a match to relight the fire. You just got to stir it a little bit. Blow it on it a little bit. And when you do that, those embers heat back up. And they'll light that wood back on fire. God is good. God is good. Sister Cowan called me this morning at 10 minutes to 8, and I knew my other responsibilities of making sure that media stuff was ready. I said, God, you better start speaking, because right in my sermon at this moment, you're going to give it to me, God. So I pulled up some notes I had on my computer, and the first one that popped up was fire. When Paul told Timothy to stir it up. And so, in doing that, and being able to blow on those embers and restart the fire, what you're doing is feeding it. You're feeding it. You see, when Paul told Timothy this, he was telling When he told them to stir it up, he was saying, you've got to feed that spirit. God gave you the spirit. You know, God says in every man there's a measure of faith. But until you tap into that measure of faith, it's not activated. It does you no good. And so, in this part, we've got to look at how did Timothy feed this flame. He told him to fan the flame that God had given him, but he said you've got to keep feeding the hot flame. You know, when somebody tells you they got a high fever or they got a temperature, they're running hot. And you check their temperature and it's like 99 point something. How many times you can touch that person and not even realize they got a fever? But you get somebody that's got 102 when it's hot, you can feel the fire. God's saying, I need you to get the fire. Paul told Timothy, keep feeding the hot flame. The reason that Paul's point is not that Timothy has grown cold. He just said, Timothy, all you've got to do, son, is stir it. Feed it. Read your Bible. Go to church. Sing to me. Give me praise and honor. Because when you do those things, the spirit I has gifted you inside will start rising up. And your flesh will become weak. And your spirit will rise up inside of you and overtake the flesh. See, right now, during this pandemic, things going on in life, it don't even have to be a pandemic or any situation that happens in life. What happens is a lot of times it grasps a hold of your flesh, the feelings of the flesh. When somebody gossips about you or talks about you, the thing that gets hurt is not your spirit, it's your flesh. Why do you say that, Pastor Tim? Because your spirit is God. And God is not offended, nor is he worried about somebody talking about you. He's not worried about your situation looking like it's bad. All he's worried about is, are you leaning on him? Are you looking at him to solve your problem? Are you looking at him to be the fire? You see, if you go forward to verse 8, Jesus says, share in suffering for the gospel. See, we have to brace this because God's giving you this gift, is what he's told Timothy. So you have to burn with the courage to speak and to suffer. People don't like to suffer. That's when it gets hard. I don't want people to look at me differently. Why you gotta suffer if you're serving in such a great God? People get this confused. You see, my wife and I are married. But if somebody else hurts me, does me wrong, it's not the one that I have a relationship's fault that I'm suffering. So why would I go to my wife and say, why are you allowing me to suffer? Why would you allow these things to happen to me in my life? My wife, she's just real talk. So if I brought an issue to her, and the reason that I'm suffering is because I walked in it, she's going to look at me and tell me, well, it's your fault. I wonder how many of us today live our life and we walk in the ways of ourself, but then we want to blame the relationship of God. Why are you allowing this to happen? God, why are you allowing it? Why are you allowing my car to get repoed? Why are you allowing my house not to get paid for? Why are you allowing these things of life to come about me? And I just wonder sometimes, is God just up there like, dude, you the one that put everything before me, and you want to blame me? You the one that haven't give a dime to my ministry and given your tithes and offerings, and you wonder why your bills ain't paid. You call on me asking why I allow you to suffer, and all I'm trying to do is get you to turn around and look to me. I gave you a fire that you don't keep burning. See, fire does amazing things. If you have a big fire and it's burning hot, there's not too many things you can throw in the fire that don't burn up. I believe if I'm burning with fire from God, when people talk about me or look at me the wrong way, or I go places that nobody, no matter who's around me or who's there, the fire of God will burn up those things. He will burn up those things when people do me wrong, so that I don't have to even remember it. See, when a fire burns up something, it turns to ashes. It's no more. It don't even get put back together. You can take out the ashes, but you ain't putting it back to its original place. You see, when you go through situations of life that are here to put you down and hurt you, when they're burned up by the fire God has inside you, they are no more allowed or able to take hold. They're no more in the form that they were created to hurt you. So when the devil puts something in your life and puts it about you, and you burn it up by the will and the ways of Jesus Christ, it can no longer be formed against you. Goes back to the scripture when God says, no weapon formed against me shall. A few people in here aren't going to let the enemy prosper. Shall what? Prosper. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. No way, no form, no way of the devil or the enemy comes against me, I will allow to form against me, because when it comes against me, I'm going to throw it in the fire that God has inside of me. You see, in 1 Timothy 4:14, Paul says, do not neglect the gift you have, which was given you by prophecy when the council of elders laid their hands on you. So many people wonder all the time, why you gotta lay hands on people? Because I'm obedient. Too many people want to be blessed from a distance from God, when God says, if you're right near me, I can embrace you. I can cover you. I can take care of you. I can lead and guide you. See, Caleb, would you help me out? I won't hurt you, I promise. You trust me? I won't hurt you. See, from this distance, I cannot guide him on where to go. I can tell him where to go, but I can't just wrap my arms around him and carry him where he needs to go. But if Caleb will allow me to hold him and pick him up. No matter what his flesh wants, no matter where his flesh wants to go, if he's in the loving arms of Christ, wherever God goes, he goes. See, if you get close enough to God and let him carry you, no matter where you want to go, God's going to take you where you need to go. Amen. So no matter where I take Caleb, he's going whether he likes it or not. In ministry, we are all called to spread the gospel of Jesus. And when you're being carried by the Father, when he's the only footsteps that people see, when he's the only footsteps that people recognize and see, when people look at you and say, that's a child of God, and he's the only steps they see, they don't see you, but they see him, then God can carry you and protect you his way. Does it mean you won't go through trials and tribulations? See, when Peter was getting close to God, listening to him, he was walking on water. But when he took his eyes off God, because he hadn't made it to him yet where God the Father could just hold him in his arms, he started sinking in the water. God isn't wanting you to get to a place that you're already sinking. Instead, he wants to carry you above the waters. He wants to carry you above the principalities of darkness in high places. He says, son, just be with me. Because when you're unashamed and speaking for Christ, courageous suffering with Christ is by the power of God in Christ. See, I pray that perhaps God would do this for some of you, that God would take away the spirit of fear and give a spirit of unashamed, courageous courage to speak and suffer for Christ in the name of Jesus. But when you're just walking with God, see, a lot of people see suffering different ways. Many people see when you follow Christ, there's a suffering because the world will persecute you. The world will talk about you. The world will look down on you for claiming Jesus Christ. So in one sense, I'm suffering from the world. But in God, I'm elevating to a new height. See, if I'm suffering with the world, I'm elevating with Christ. But if I'm suffering with Jesus and I'm elevating with the world, elevating with the world means that you're dying and going to hell. It means the fire is not burning. And so when you fan a flame, it's a continuous thing. So that's the misconception so badly in the world today, that they believe I get saved and I'm good to go. But see, I don't believe Paul would have told Timothy to fan the flame if he was just good to go, if he didn't need to do nothing else in life but ask God to be in his life and he's good to go. Come into my heart, I'm good to go. No, he said fan the flame. Means that you got to continuously throughout your life read the Bible, pray, follow the order of the steps of the Lord, so that his spirit will be strong in your life and it will never dwindle down where it's no longer there. You see, that's what happens if you see these big forest fires they have, I think, in like California. They bring plane loads of water trying to put this fires out, it keeps burning. They can't stop it. They just put water in water and it keeps burning. But now you take a little house fire and you throw a plane load of fire on it, it's going to probably knock it out. So instead, the fire department doesn't even have to take a plane. They just take a fire truck with a one hose. Now, granted to you, if you have a house fire, doesn't mean things aren't going to get damaged. Doesn't mean a lot of things won't get destroyed. But it means if just a little water comes, it can wipe it out. So what I believe God is trying to say, son, you can't just have a little fire burning within you, because the next storm that comes your way is going to wipe you out. The next storm that comes your way, you're going to think God don't exist anymore. Instead, I want to be a force fire. How do I have that? Because you by yourself is a house fire. But when you're in a group and a gathering of people in the church house, you are gathered around many house fires. And when many house fires get together, one little fire and one little storm won't put it out. Because you can run right next door to the next house and all be taken care of. Why? Because you can depend on your brothers and sisters to lift you up. They'll pick you up. Somebody needs to help. Somebody's fire burn this morning. When you look over and see their fire's not burning hot, quite bright, you come over and say, let me pray with you. You get on your knees earnestly within the week. You say, I'm praying for your brother. I'm praying for your sister. I'm praying for the needs in your life, because we need a forest fire. We need a church on fire to save the lost and dying world. I need a church that's ready to see the gospel of Jesus Christ on fire for the kingdom of God. Because we've got too many house fires that are being burned out. Because there's not enough church fires to keep on burning. God, I need you to burn. Help me keep my fire stirred up. Help me have enough grace for the one beside me. And when I have grace for those around me, it means that when they're struggling and their fire is dim, and even if it may be their fault, even if my wife said it's your fault, you put yourself in that predicament, it may be true. But God, give me grace that you have given me to look at them and pray for them anyways. To pray for them knowing that God had grace for me. God had grace for me. That he sent his only begotten son to die for me. And if God's grace would come after me, and if my fire is burning bright, then I can look at those around me and not condemn them or look down on them because their fire is not burning. But instead, I'm going to pray that my fire will spread out and that I can cause a church fire to erupt and that it'll overtake and it will consume their fire to be lit again. You see, if you take your fire that's burned out, it may be soaked wet, drenched from a storm that just took place. But if you take that old, wet, soaked down wood over to a fire that's brightly burning hot, that fire will consume that storm that was inside that other fire, that other wood, and make it burn again. Church, I come to you today asking, are you stirring up the spirit inside of you? Just enough to know that, God, I know you're there. I know you hear my prayers, you hear my cries. God, I know you see me late at night before I go to bed, pray to you, asking you to keep my soul. Are you going to God in a daily, continuous prayer? All throughout the day, listening to the Father speak, thinking about those around you, praying continuously for those around you, saying, God, as you keep me stirred up, let my flame touch those around me and keep them burning. Keep them burning. Help them see you through me, knowing that if they'll keep their fire burning, no matter what sickness comes my way, no matter what heartache comes to my way, no matter what suffering I come about, no matter when the disciples got thrown in prison, when Paul and Silas got thrown in prison, they didn't go thinking, God, why you allow this suffering on me? But they went into the prison house with a song of fire. And they started singing the praises of heaven. And it didn't just break the chains of bondage on them, but it consumed those that had them in bondage for wrongdoing. It consumed the man that was watching over them, wanting to know, man, who is this God they have? When Joseph went to prison for being misaccused, he went, the Bible says, with a smile on his face. And when he walked in the jailhouse, the other men said, how can you smile when you've just been put in this place? Joseph went into the prison doors with a smile on his face. Not because of where he was, because he knew that no matter what place he was at, even if it was in a pit left to die, that God was with him. So I'm here to tell somebody this morning, no matter where you at, no matter what pit God has you in, no matter what suffering you feel like you're at, that if your fire stays burning, you can smile through every situation. You can smile through the pits of hell that come about you. You can smile in the prison doors when God is with you. Why? Because your hope is not in this world, but your hope is in the one who sent you. The hope is in the fire that burns within you. My hope this morning is in Jesus Christ alone. It's not in nothing else around me. It's only in Jesus Christ alone. So no matter where I go, when I go to the doctors, my confidence is not in the doctor that I don't know. It's not in his name title. It's not in his position. But it's in knowing that if God led me to this doctor, that God ordained me to see, then my faith is in that God has his hand on him, that God gave him the knowledge to perform the things that he does, not because who he is, but because of who God is in him. So that when I go places, it doesn't matter if they believe in Jesus or not. It doesn't matter what their belief is. Because the one who's inside of me that's burning is with me. So no matter where I go, the Bible says that God will be with you in hell itself. Because if he's with you, no matter who comes around you, no matter who sees you, no matter who touches you, God has his final say. Yes, it's a blessing to have doctors that believe in Jesus. Yes, it's a blessing to believe, to see doctors that know Jesus. But I believe no matter where I go, just like Paul and Silas, they didn't focus on the belief of that prison guard. They focused on the God who they believed in that will soon deliver that prison guard. And see, I believe when I go places, no matter who I see, no matter who I come about, that the people that see me will see God himself. That no matter what they believe or no matter what they thought they believed in, once they encounter the fire of Jesus, they will encounter a difference in their life that will last forever. See, when you encounter me, it lasts for a moment. When you encounter Jesus, his encounter lasts forever. Stand with me. Stand with me, if you will. These altars are always open. No matter when throughout the service, they're always open. I believe altars are very important. God wouldn't have created altars in the Word of God if they wouldn't be there, shouldn't be there. I don't know why. Altars seem to scare people or afraid to walk down. I know that's a battle of the flesh. But I look at altars as a place that God created and designed. He designed the whole house. But when I walk down here, there's a spirit inside that changes. There's an embracing that changes. It's almost like when I walk down here that God picks me up. And it's holding me. And when I'm just here, all I can see is here. And know that God is before me. And I don't worry about what's behind me. I don't matter. I don't think about who's looking at me, who's not. My focus just changes. But it seems like when I stand in the chair in the aisles, my eyes easily get drifted off in those things that are still in front of me. Those things to my right and to my left, the ones that are in front of me, watching to see what they do or their reactions. And God is telling somebody this morning that I didn't put the person beside you just so that you can see them stir their gift. Paul didn't tell Timothy, I'm going to stir my gift up, and you do nothing. But he said, Timothy, Stir it up, son. Fan the flame that God created inside of you. And so when I come down to this altar, I like the call of alterations. Because I believe when you step this way, you're saying, God, I need you to alter my life. I'm coming down to that altar for some alterations this morning. There's some holes within my belief and my spirit that need to be patched up. There's some sewing that needs to be done. See, my mother-in-law, she knows this amazing sewing lady. And I tell you, if anything happens to any clothes, she's rushing them to her house. Why? Not because she wants her to just look at them, look at the issues going on, but she wants her to fix the issues that's going on. And I believe God is waiting and looking, saying, who's going to come to me looking for a fixing? Who's going to come to me wanting some alterations done in their life? Who's going to run down to my altar that I created and ordained for a purpose and planned for them? Who's going to come asking me? Who's going to fan their flame through obedience of my word and worship me? Through the obedience of my word and their giving. Through the obedience of my word, through prayer. People struggle with that. Why I got to pray to God when he knows all things? Because he says so. Why do you tell your children to repeat after you? Why do you ask them things you already know? You want to see if they'll be honest and tell you the truth. I wonder how many people this morning that God is asking, are you going to come be honest with me? Are you going to come tell me the truth that I already know? Are you going to stand there and tell me you're not struggling when I know you are? Are you going to tell me you're not going through situations when I know you are? Are you going to tell me your spirit needs fanning when it doesn't need fanning, that you're okay when I know you're not? And wonder where I'm at when Monday comes. When all I've asked you to do is fan the flame. All I've asked you to do is be honest with me. Jesus is for real. I like that shirt. How many know that Jesus is for real? How many people around you, when you leave the church house, know that Jesus is for real in your life? By the way that you walk and you talk and you smile and you look at them, is it old me on Monday morning? Is it I've got this issue and this issue? Or is it God is real? Is that, you know what, I went through this, but Jesus is real. Say with me, Jesus. Come on, church, Jesus. Come on, Jesus. Man, if people could shout Jesus. When the problems come, Jesus. When troubles come my way, Jesus. When I see things happen around me, Jesus. Why? Because I know Jesus. Jesus. Jesus is real. He's not just a made-up God, but he's my God. He is all God. He's the only God. These altars are open this morning. If you need prayer, or if you need just some time with Jesus alone, or if you need a time of shouting praise to God, Jesus is here. There are those that will pray with you, that will love on you. Love. The greatest commandment of God is love. Who is showing God, I love you this morning? The Bible says the greatest commandment is love. It wasn't just speaking about showing love for one another, but it was about, are you showing God you love Him? Play When I Think About the Lord again. Sing these words and think on those. How many can come down to the altar this morning and show God I love them? How many is wanting to be some fire starters, some flamethrowers, and showing God that I'm ready to start a church fire? I don't just want my house to burn, but I want my neighbor's house to burn for Jesus. I want my co-worker's house to burn for Jesus. I want those who don't like me to heap coals of fire over their heads so that they know that God is in me, that God is burning. His fire is burning with me this morning. You pick me up. You turn me around. You change my life. And now I'm going to shout.
Glory and all the honor and all the praise.
about the Lord. How he picked me up and turned me around. How he placed my feet on solid ground. Hey, it makes me want to shout. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise.
Come on, lift it up, say it makes me want to shout.
Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory, hey, all the honor and all the praise. You know it makes me want to shout, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Makes me want to shout.
Hey.
Hey.
Makes me want to shout. Sunday to Sunday, Sunday through Sunday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Amen. Church, we love you. We're here for you. If you need anything, please let us know. Please let our staff know. If it's your first time, please make sure you let our leaders know. We have a special gift for you. To our young people, we're having a cookout today with some fun and games at starting at 5 o'clock to all of our youth people. So come be with us. But we love you. As Pastor says, shake hands and be friendly.
You turn mourning to dancing. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. Turn graves into gardens. You turn foes into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning into dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame to glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only.